Nissan fans have been waiting a long, long time for the all-new Z, and it's finally here. And to be fair, the last time I drove the previous Z, I was a bit nonplussed by that experience. This one, however, is the right one. It's got a 6-speed manual gearbox, so let's see if we can get a little non-nonplussed. What's it like? Buckle up and let's go for a drive. I'm your host, Brian Max, racer, lover of driving fast, fun things. And on this channel, you get reviews for drivers from drivers. Now, the Z has always promised to be fast and fun, and it's been a while since the Z has been completely redone, and yet here we are. And before we get into what this new Z is like to drive, let's have a look at it in a little more depth. At this point, we know the platform is a development of the old Z, as well as that same platform that they used under various Infinities, which is not necessarily a bad thing, but this being all new, it is fairly different than the previous Z. Gone is the naturally aspirated V6, and it's replaced with a twin turbo that makes 400 horsepower at 6,400 RPM and 350 pounds of torque from 1,600 to 5,200 RPM. Transmissions are either this 6-speed manual or a 9-speed automatic. The manual does come with switchable rev matching, and thankfully it's switchable. The drive shaft is carbon fiber. Because this is a manual, it's got a mechanical clutch type limited slip diff in the back. Speaking of manuals, it does have a launch control function for the manual gearbox. Steering is electrically assisted. Suspension's based around double wishbones at the front with a strut tower brace, multi-link at the rear, conventional dampers, not the adaptive type. Because this one is the performance model, it's got 4-piston front brakes instead of two, bigger rotors, 2-piston calipers at the rear instead of single piston. Standard wheels and tires are 18s. This one comes on the optional forged 19s with Bridgestone Potenza S007s. Curb weight of the new Z ranges from about 3,500 to 3,600 pounds. The automatic transmission means a 63-pound penalty over the manual gearbox. And weight distribution of this new Z is 56% front, 44% rear. But on this channel, we know it's not static weight distribution that counts. It's how you use it. Did you know that 80% of you are not subscribed? Yes, it's true. I checked the stats. So do me a favor, hit the subscribe button, like this, share this, tell your friends. And of course, be sure to hit up our merch store. There's lots of great stuff for driving enthusiasts like us, including our very popular line of Save the Manuals merch. Overall, they've got the driver interface dialed. It is quite good. The ergonomics about this are a little odd, specifically with the seat controls. There's some power seat controls here, and then there's some outboard dials on the seats that adjust the cushion. It's a little odd, a little bit different. I'm sure it's a Z thing, but after that, you're set up perfectly here. Great interface to the steering wheel, as well as the pedals. Decent amount of adjustment in the steering column as well. Love the dead pedal for my left foot, and love the layout for the pedals. Love the shape of the steering wheel as well. It's been a little while since I've driven anything Nissan or Infiniti. Maybe it's a little bit too large in terms of overall diameter, but the shape is perfect. It encourages you to have your hands at 9 and 3. The digital instrument cluster is spot on, gives you exactly the information you're looking for, and it's very, very clear. The infotainment system is pretty straightforward. I just use it on Apple CarPlay and it works wonderfully. The climate controls are almost secondary because they are automatic. It's one of those things where you just set them and forget them. The gauges atop the dash are a little bit unnecessary. They're a little bit redundant. You don't really need to see what's going on with the turbo speed or the voltage output of the alternator. The boost gauge is kind of a nice touch. I'm sure some kids will like that, but I really don't need to see those there. Overall, I'm genuinely impressed with the cabin, the way it's styled, because it is very modern and it's just the right amount of tech for a 2023 model year Z. The seats themselves are comfortable and supportive, really no complaints there. And the best part about this seating position is that I'm very low in the chassis. I'm seated right off the floor. It's exactly what I want from a seating position. And then, of course, you can see out of this Z in all directions fairly easily. Yes, you can complain about the C pillars being big and maybe obstructing your view, but if you know how to adjust your mirrors properly,
blind spots aren't a thing.
In terms of spaciousness, well, what you see is what you get. There are some cup holders here. I think if you flip this up, there's an extra cup holder there. There's some bottle holders in the doors, and otherwise there's a minimal amount of storage around the cabin, and there's some storage under the hatch. Right now I've got a backpack, a carry-on sized case, and a couple of other little things, and that's about all you can carry in your 2023 Z. This thing does move. I think the official numbers for the manual for 0 to 60 are 4.5 seconds. Definitely feels quicker than that. And yes, there is a launch control function for the manual. I think that's just circus tricks. I don't think you really need to mess with that. Plus, if you want to drive and experience the manual properly, you have to understand how to launch your manual gearbox equipped Z. Top speed is about 155 miles an hour, if I remember correctly, and that is electronically limited. Not quite sure why they do that, haven't investigated that, but that's more than fast enough in this part of the world. Certainly more than fast enough for a lot of the racetracks that I would drive on as well. I think if we looked at the power and torque curves of this motor, we'd find that it's not so linear. It seems to come on once we get into the mid-range. I'd like to have a look at those, but what I do find is mid-range is strong as far as torque goes. There's just torque for days out of this twin turbo V6. This is kind of the best of both worlds. It's a modern turbocharged engine, so it makes lots of torque in the low and mid-range, and then peak power is up near redline. It's brilliant. The limited slip diff works wonderfully for me. This thing pulls out of corners perfectly, and it is well balanced. We'll discuss handling in a little bit, but I'm very impressed with the limited slip diff, as I am with this gearbox. They've done a fantastic job with this gearbox. The gates are clearly defined. It's very easy to shift. Control weights are spot on. There's a little bit of effort you need to shift between gears, and then the weight of the clutch also matches. I think the one thing that doesn't quite match here is brake pedal effort, which we'll talk about. I wouldn't say that the clutch has a lot of feel to it, but it is clear in terms of how you're releasing the clutch and the amount of forward motion that you're getting and how that clutch is engaging. So very happy with the clutch, very, very happy with the shifter. They've done a fine job of resolving this manual gearbox. One of the other things I like about this drivetrain is that it is much more refined than the previous generation. Yes, it's been a while, but that previous generation's drivetrain was with us for a long, long time, and I would often describe it as agricultural, and this is not the same thing. This is much more refined. The engine is smooth, it's powerful, it's torquey, and then this manual gearbox is properly refined and engineered as well. The one thing that this does have is the magic button for rev matching, which we don't use on this channel. It might help with someone who's new to a manual gearbox, but we know how to heel and toe on this channel. If you don't, there's a link here and below to our heel and toe video. If you don't know how to do that, or are curious, or want to refine your technique, just click on that link and I'll show you how to do that properly. In terms of handling, I'm pleasantly surprised. This does feel light on its toes. It makes a fantastic dance partner in the corners, and that has to do with a lot of things. One of the things I'm impressed with is the excellent body and wheel control of the dampers. This suspension does a fantastic job of managing body and wheel control. Yes, on the performance model, we do have the lightweight forged wheels, which makes the damper's job a little bit easier, but I'm very, very impressed. Excellent in transitions, excellent coming out of corners, and in terms of steering, I find that it's well weighted because it is electrically assisted. We don't get a lot of feel or feedback coming through the wheel, but we do get excellent feel and feedback through the chassis, as well through the brake pedal. We get decent feel and feedback from that brake pedal. The complaint I have about the brake pedal is that it's overly assisted, and this is
a big thing for me because I do like all of my control weights to be balanced, and that is throttle, steering, brake, clutch, shifter. They all need to have some harmony. And what I find with this brake pedal is that it's overly assisted. So when I jump on the brake pedal, well, it doesn't take much to get a whole lot of pedal pressure. And then of course you get a little bit more braking than you'd like. Once you become accustomed to it, what you end up doing is braking lightly with a light amount of pedal effort. And then when you get on the throttle, well, you're using a lot of pedal pressure there. It's not quite harmonious in terms of the control weights being balanced in the Z, but it's a very minor complaint because I do like the brakes. Love how these brakes work. Great feel, great feedback, great power. And this does feel very poised under braking. And then of course, accelerating out of corners, through corners, beautifully balanced. I find this to be very, very neutral. Maybe you can encourage a little bit of understeer if you're not so smooth with your throttle inputs, but overall, lovely balance with this new Z. Love that. Love how the torque comes on. Yeah, in the corners, it's just a delight. And this road is horrific. It's got a terrible surface. That is not the car. That's my junk in the back that's rolling around. But I do love the overall ride and handling of this new Z. It's not overly harsh on rough surfaces like this. It's quite comfortable and the ride is fairly compliant. What they've been able to do with the ride and handling is find a great compromise between ride comfort and overall handling. What you do find on a day-to-day basis or on some rougher road surfaces like this, it is very comfortable, very compliant, great feel and feedback from this chassis. Love that. We were sliding just a little bit there and the chassis told me exactly what it was doing. You can feel what's going on in each contact patch and I'm very impressed with the chassis feel. But yes, overall ride and handling, great balance between ride comfort and outright handling. I'm very, very impressed with what they've done with the suspension. Very comfortable on a day-to-day basis, and you can certainly take this on a long, long road trip and be very comfortable. How do you spec yours? Well, this is an easy question to answer because this one is properly spec'd, save for the color. Base price in the US is a little over 42. Add in the performance model and the two-tone blue and black paint, you get 53,505 as tested. In Canada, it's a little over 49, plus the performance model, plus the blue and black two-tone paint. And as tested, you're a little shy of $60,000 before freight and local taxes. And yes, this is the right one. Maybe blue isn't my choice, but you do need the performance model for the bigger brakes, as well as the lighter wheels and the manual with the limited slip diff. This is the way to spec your Nissan Z. My verdict? Well, let's start with fuel consumption, only because it's surprisingly good. I'm averaging about 23 miles per gallon, or a little over 10 liters per 100 kilometers for my Canadian friends, and that is impressive given the amount of power and torque that this thing makes, but it's a testament to modern turbocharged engines. I'm very impressed, and regular viewers of the show know that I'm not afraid to use the throttle, so color me impressed with fuel consumption on its own. As for the new Z, well, this is something else. I'm not sure what I was expecting, but as soon as I got behind the wheel, I was massively impressed. The interior design impressed me right from the drop. And then after that, I'm impressed with the seating position, the driver interface, a couple of minor complaints, but the chassis is impressive as well. And the fact of the matter is the world does need more manual transmission equipped sports cars. So on those grounds, I think this new Z was absolutely worth the wait and I'm definitely nonplussed. Thanks for hanging out with me today and having a look at this 2023 Nissan Z. Hope you liked this episode, and if you did, well, you're not new to YouTube, you know what to do. Smash the subscribe button, turn on your notifications, like this video, and as always, sharing is caring, so please share this with your friends, especially on Reddit, because on Reddit, they really need to see reviews for drivers from drivers. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them in the comments below. I'll get back to you as soon as I can. And if you want to support the channel, please hit up our merch store. Links here, links below, lots of great stuff for driving enthusiasts like us, including our very popular line of Save the Manuals merch. Thanks again for watching. We'll see you again next time. And remember, cars don't understeer by themselves, not even Nissan Zs.